Good morning. You do lots of preparation for these kinds of things and then realise that the one thing that you want to sort of start with, you don't know. Because I'd like to ask you a question. And it's actually prompted by Julian's presentation earlier, where I was really struck by his point around people who've got the Force and people who don't. But I actually don't know enough about Star Wars to know who's the person with the Force. Is that the Jedi? Or is that the Darth Vader? I'm feeling I need my five-year-old boy here with me now because he would be able to tell me. But assuming that marketeers are the people with the Force, and they're the Jedi, is that right? Is that right? Yeah? Who knows? Anybody know about Star Wars?
Let's go with that.
Let's go with that, right. So put your hand up if you think you're a Jedi. So you've got the Force. Okay, well, that's a good proportion of the room. And how many people are they Darth Vader? I don't know who they are, but the sustainability, the Sith. So who's a Sith who is a sustainability expert but doesn't have that kind of marketing and brand expertise? Right, well, that is a very good proportion of the room who have got the Force. And I guess the final question is, who's got both? Okay, right, well, it looks to me like we might be winning. I confess that myself, I am a lifelong campaigner. I started in politics, ended up working in FMCG almost by error, thinking I kind of want to reform from within. I went to work for Cadbury, and I actually spent 10 years at Cadbury, joined Sainsbury's a year ago. And actually, whilst I was at Cadbury, I went and spent 4 years in marketing and became a marketing director. So I've got both hands in the air, I guess, this morning, as somebody who is both a sustainability geek and also a marketing shiny person. And the thing that I learned when I went to work in marketing is that people in marketing can make really boring things seem very shiny, which was part of the reason I was attracted to it. So whilst I absolutely agreed with everything that Julian was saying about some of the mirror that we need to kind of hold up to ourselves in terms of sustainable marketing, at the same time, I'm also a secret geek Sith. And I actually do believe that the kind of the rigor and the analytical side of kind of that part of me is actually a really important part of this debate, and we shouldn't kind of lose touch with it for too much. There are probably two reasons for that. One is something around not underestimating the consumer. And not underestimating the complexity of the questions that the consumer has got, and the fact that fundamentally, no matter how shiny your things are, you're probably only as good in their eyes as the kind of the worst dark secret. So sort of having some Siths working away on those things is incredibly important. The second thing is probably to do with the factor of the sector that I'm working in. So Sainsbury's as a retailer covers a huge span of issues, of opportunities, and actually there is a sort of sense of responsibility across all of those things. So I'm going to talk to you about Sainsbury's. It's a 150-year-old company. I'm not expecting you to be able to read that. That's a sort of potted history of the kind of last 150 years in terms of activities on CSR. There's a copy of our recently published CSR report here, and in an attempt to meet the needs of both Siths and Jedi, I'm not sure this analogy is working for me, but online there's a huge amount of detail, but we have actually produced probably one of the slimmest corporate responsibility reports that you will find that is very much story-led, partly for that reason that actually cutting through the detail, giving people the reassurance that the detail is there is important, but it's also important to kind of cut through on a few things. This morning I'm going to talk to you about two things. One, the Paralympics, which is probably the thing that most people are associating with the Sainsbury's brand right now in terms of sustainability. We're actually up for Brand of the Year at the Marketing Society tonight on the back of it, so please cross your fingers for us this evening. And the second is some consumer insight, because I'm assuming that many of you will want to kind of go back to your your marketing teams, you know, whether you're in it or associated with it, and actually sort of share some insight in terms of kind of how we're seeing what the consumer is actually looking for. Sustainability has been part of Sainsbury's history, but it's also been part of the company's turnaround. Some of you may know that after many years of leading the retail sector in the UK, Sainsbury's went through quite a sort of troublesome period. And it was actually what would now, I guess, be called crowdsourcing, an exercise in crowdsourcing that actually led to the creation of the strategy, which was called Making Sainsbury's Great Again, that also recognised how values needed to play an integral part of the brand. It had paid a huge part of its past. It really needed to be integrated as part of its future. So we do have a belief that our values make us different, or have the power to make us different and to differentiate. And these are the five values. The piece of crowdsourcing was that our CEO just quite simply wrote to a million customers and said, what is it that you want from Sainsbury's? 250,000 actually wrote back to him. You know, it was free. And they didn't have any other reason to do this other than that they wanted to tell him what they wanted from Sainsbury's. He also initiated a program called Tell Justin, his name's Justin, which was targeted at the colleague base. So there's 150,000 people who work for Sainsbury's. And that program has been something that has continued over the past 8 years and is a source of huge insight, not just around what the colleagues are thinking, but also what they're hearing from customers. And it's really part of making them part of making sure that our values do make us different. So these are the five values. They kind of tell the story of Sainsbury's. We're fundamentally a grocer, therefore we have a responsibility around feeding people. We source from countries all around the world. Customers expect us to sort of make those decisions, those sourcing decisions on their behalf. We are, if you like, doing the transaction that previously they might have done before, so they expect us to source with integrity. The scale of our business, the scale of the resources that we're essentially using and distributing means that the environment, we can have a massive negative or positive impact on the environment. Whilst we're a business, we're essentially a local business. There are 1,000 stores up and down the country. Wherever we are, people expect us to be part of the community, whether that's about paying local rates, whether that's about paying our national taxes, which is very topical at the moment, whether that's about the jobs that we create and who gets employed in them, and also, of course, what we do in our communities in terms of community sponsorship and engagement. And fundamentally, by being a great place to work, that's actually a huge part of our success. As I say, 150,000 people, you cannot buy from Sainsbury's without touching a Sainsbury's person, whether it's the person at the checkout who's helping you with your shopping, or the person at the self-checkout scan who's actually helping you figure out how to use it, I would say. Or indeed if it's online and you know, your groceries are being delivered to your door. So having colleagues who are massively engaged in the organisation, understand the values and also understand kind of great service is a huge part of what we're about, and I'll come on to that. Last year we decided that having had the values in place for about 5 years, that it was time for us to kind of kick on. And so we introduced a programme called 20 by 20, which is 20 commitments for the year 2020. Each of them sits broadly under one of the values. In fact, we've just undergone a kind of, it now is called crowdsourcing. We've done a kind of crowdsourcing exercise with an organisation called Green Mondays, where we had 160 experts, people who did sustainability in other companies, including kind of peer companies, basically rip it apart, put it together and tell us live what they thought about it. That was quite an interesting, nerve-wracking experience, but I think, you know, generated some great insights for us and for the internal management team, as well as a kind of a to-do list for other people. If anybody's interested in that, email me afterwards and I'm more than happy to sort of send you some information about it. And then last week we did the same thing again, but with people who actually were engaged with us, you know, what we Siths called stakeholders, the people who are the organisations that we're working with on a sort of day-to-day basis. Again, 140 of those plus 60 of our team who are actually working on it to actually have a live session to say, okay, 1 year on from publishing the plan, are we focusing on the right things? Where are the holes in what we're doing and what should we be doing more of? But kind of moving kind of back to the consumer side of things, what we know is that you need to be close to your consumer. And that means that you've got to be a step or a couple of steps ahead of them. You can't be too far ahead. You can't be disconnected from them. They've got to kind of ultimately want to go to the place that you want to get to. But you shouldn't expect that the consumer of today will tell you exactly what you should be doing. Those consumers are at the heart of everything that we do, and our consumer proposition, what we, if you like, kind of market to consumers, is something called Live Well for Less. That's our kind of marketing tagline. Some of you may well be aware of it. When I come on to the consumer side of the consumer insight, I'll talk a little bit more about that, and I think you'll really start to sort of see how we see that has got huge power and potential to be something very different. But on to the Paralympics. How many of you actually kind of went to the Paralympics? How many, keep your hand up if you kind of expected to go to the Paralympics maybe 3 years ago? Much lower number. And I think that really plays into our understanding of the Paralympics. The Paralympics was something that, if you actually sort of stepped back, one of the most common questions that we are asked about sponsorship of the Paralympics is, what, you know, kind of why on earth did you decide to do that? We were the first company to actually only sponsor the Paralympics. Paralympics has sort of traditionally been this sort of second prize that you get after you've sponsored the Olympics. Then, you know, will you sponsor the Paralympics as well? And it was very much a kind of, you know, junior player in the two, and you know, the kind of the one of the Paralympics organisers was telling me that if we sort of step back to when London first won the Games, that they were seeing you know, comments in consumer groups along the lines of, why on earth would I want to go to the Paralympics? You know, I spend all of my time sort of trying to avoid that kind of issue. So when Sainsbury's got involved, it was seen as quite a brave move for an organisation. For us, it wasn't something that we saw as brave. It actually really resonated with our company values. One in eight people in the UK has a caring responsibility and rising. Our employee base is the UK. We've got 22 million customers. So, you know, those are microcosms of society out there. So it really for us felt like a kind of quite natural fit. However, we didn't underestimate the fact that we probably were a couple of steps ahead here of where the rest of the world was. And so we actually needed to approach this as something that was far more than a badge. This wasn't just about sort of lobbing your logo next to some, you know, other event or logo and sort of having the halo just sort of shine across your brand. That what we actually needed to do was to become part of the Olympic and Paralympic movements, that we needed to actually be part of making sure that the Games itself was a success. And there were three phases to that. So one was around involving our colleagues, and we created a fan base right from the very offset because they needed to kind of get the Paralympics more than the customers or be ahead of the customers. And we found all kinds of stories that kind of came to light. People who had disabilities who had never felt that they could tell somebody at work, that people who had disabled children or disabled relatives, and again, it had been this sort of secret that people were not bringing to their working life. This point that was made by Michael about, you know, are people actually sort of being one person at home and then when they come into work being something else? So it's been a hugely liberating piece for our colleagues. The second was around the communities that we serve. We already had our Active Kids program, so by opening that up and making that something that was about Active Kids for All, we were able to really build on that. And we we took the view that actually what we would do is we would go to the schools and to the children to actually help them understand Paralympic sports. So they hadn't necessarily come across things like goalball or blind football. And through our programme, we were able to do that. And then the third thing was customers. So 18 million people actually went to the Paralympics through Sainsbury's, either through winning tickets in competitions. We sold a huge amount of Bags for Life, which was with the proceeds going back to the British Paralympics Association, and started that well before the Games. A quick video to bring that all to life, because I can talk about it, but there's nothing like actually seeing it.
I love it, to bits and pieces. So thank you very much, Sainsbury's.
Everyone doing it has got their own story and their own reason for being here, and I think that's a really important part of what Sainsbury's is supporting for the Games.
Next door to tears, actually, with jubilation. Absolutely fantastic.
It's a real achievement, and I'm so pleased. Thank you. Thank you to Sainsbury's for absolutely everything.
Amazing, and I felt an honour to be here today. It was a privilege, and it's once in a lifetime. It really is. It's fantastic. Go there, Sainsbury's!
Say, I'm a bit next to tears, actually. Every time I watch it, it really makes me understand and appreciate the power of when you actually approach something with both the shininess of the Jedi and also the kind of integrity and rigour of the Sith. So anyway, where are consumers now? Doing the Paralympics was a bet against where consumers were. Actually, in the economic downturn, many people also thought that consumers were going to walk away from, from values more generally. And what we have recently published is a piece of insight, which is the insight that we have with inside Sainsbury's, partly to sort of share our understanding that actually what we've seen in the economic downturn is quite the opposite. We have not seen people walk away from their values. We've actually seen connection to values and the importance attached to values hardened, and that's partly been due to kind of increased empathy. It's partly been to do with some of the concerns, the bigger concerns that people have about the state of the world, about the state of business. There's a report which I'm happy to, I've got copies for anybody who wants it, but I'm going to sort of start again by actually showing you a video so that you can actually see what consumers are saying.
Like most people, I really do care about the environment, and I really want Sainsbury's to take decisions for me that they can, that are beyond my control, and so I can buy from them with confidence.
I'd look at price first, because that's really important at the moment, and then I'd look where they've come from.
If I buy an item and it's Sainsbury's, I've, like, wrote on it about free range and source the food adequately, then yes, I do trust it and I would buy it.
It's quite a terrifying thing, the whole thought of our kids not being able to eat seafood when they're our age and that kind of thing.
Sainsbury is very careful about where they source the product from.
I've got 10 grandchildren and 7 great-grandchildren, so naturally I want to make sure that they're okay for the future.
People assume that cooking meals from scratch can be expensive, but I think it can be done on a budget.
We don't compromise on quality.
Ugly veg isn't a bother to me. It doesn't really matter what it looks like, as long as it tastes all right. That's a problem. I'm going to chop it up anyway.
I'm perfectly happy with the basic range, with the quality, where they source the goods. I do look for British products if I can possibly get them.
So whenever I can, I try and buy food that comes from Britain, and that's why I'm really quite pleased that Sainsbury's is making all their bread with 100% British wheat.
I would buy sustainably sourced fish, because of the trouble that British fisheries are in.
I am pleased by this sign, the Union Jack.
They have a massive responsibility because a lot of people, well, most people do the shopping, big shop in a supermarket, and they assume that their stuff is sustainably sourced. It's going to be the best quality they can find. They assume that the farmer hasn't been bent over a barrel where they're getting it from.
Paralympics was amazing. We had Alexandra Rickman in yesterday, showing off her medal, which was really lovely. Customers had photos, children, so really good.
Live well, bless. I suppose it's taking the children out and nature walks and things rather than going cinema.
With active kids, we do really well at this store. Obviously, because every £10 you spend, you get an active kid voucher. The kids absolutely love it. They can't wait to come shopping to obviously get their active kid voucher. It's always like a little race to get who can get the most.
I do trust Sainsbury to give me good food.
Yeah. So the report is called New Fashion Values, and what we're seeing is that, as I say, in the economic downturn, values have actually become more important. People are wanting to understand how doing the right thing can become part of everyday life. They don't want to pay a premium for it. They don't expect to. And much in the same way that businesses have, if you like, kind of put business plans behind their sustainability choices and their sustainability plans, the consumer's doing the same thing, essentially. But they do have complex questions. I don't know how many of you. I mean, we did not handpick those people, I have to say. You know, this was a broad cross-section. It was done in a very unmanaged way, and what we found was that actually people's use, even of the S word, the sustainability word, was there. They do phrase things differently. They do talk about not wanting to see farmers bent over a barrel, but they've got exactly the same issues. In the interest of time, because I know we're overrunning and there's coffee, I'm not going to go through each of them. As I say, if you go to our website, you'll be able to find it pretty easily. If you don't find me also enjoying the caffeine. But there are 5 distinct parts to the kind of the mega trend, if you like, which we're calling new fashion values. The one thing I would say is, first of all, it's across a lot of issues. So, you know, that is where your license to sort of cherry pick is limited. And the second is that it's across all socioeconomic groups. So I was expecting our analysis to sort of show that, you know, the highly educated and those with kind of money to care actually were sort of much cleverer on these things than everybody else and much more passionate about them. We don't see that. And in fact, you can actually argue that perhaps the inverse is reversed. And, you know, to draw on my kind of old Labour as well as new Labour piece, perhaps those at the top of the pyramid don't need to worry too much about these things. Live well for less, as I said, is our kind of overall philosophy for Sainsbury's moving forward. And that, you know, really, when you sort of stop and think about it, that is about sort of promising people that you know, it won't cost them the earth in the kind of the literal sense of their shopping, but it is also about the you know, the higher ideal around the fact that actually we don't need to be a world of conspicuous consumption, and that's not what people are wanting. You know, there is this return, perhaps to the make do and mend, perhaps to the waste less, want less type of philosophy of previous generations. We were talking about the fact that, you know, we're perhaps a sort of nation either of baby boomers or brought up by baby boomers, and I really love the idea, Julian, of oldies and youngies actually together kind of having many of the answers to these things, because they're repurposed for the current environment, but a lot of the answers probably do lie kind of back to the future rather than just in the future. Thank you.